Paribas Subdui.
Tonight, on First at 9, this Sunday, the 18th of February, 2024. Committed. President engages in an observational tour in Gaul and Tangaul in a bid to improve the already picking up tourism numbers. Reaffirmed. US Undersecretary for Public Diplomacy, Elizabeth M. Allen, meets Sri Lanka's Foreign Secretary. Reaffirms US support to Sri Lanka's journey towards economic stability. High-level visit. Iranian Foreign Minister to undertake an official visit to Sri Lanka from the 19th to the 21st of February.
Obe Vishwasi Dino Sensodyne, then Lagamethi Pharmacy in Labagata Hacker.
This is Ada Verana First at 9, live from Studio 24 in Colombo.
Good evening and welcome to Ada Verana First at 9. I'm Aditya Dhrisinghe joining you live with the latest in Sri Lanka and around the world. Now in your top story tonight, the country's health sector, marred by tensions, strikes and crises, faces a new threat with the Doctors' Union Alliance for Medical and Civil Rights revealing a severe shortage of surgical equipment integral for both simple and complex surgeries island-wide. Meanwhile, in a separate development, the health sector trade unions are scheduled to meet the Minister of Health, Dr. Ramesh Pathirunan, tomorrow morning. Speaking further in this regard, the Alliance of the Health Sector Trade Unions warned that a decision regarding further strikes will be taken if the discussion with the health minister fails.
Over the past few weeks, members affiliated to 72 health sector trade unions engaged in nationwide strikes on multiple occasions demanding an allowance equivalent to the debt allowance of 35,000 rupees provided only to doctors. However, on the 15th of February, the strike actions came to a halt after the Ministry of Health agreed in writing to further discuss the matter with the unions. Accordingly, the collective of health trade unions are scheduled to meet Minister of Health Dr. Ramesh Pathirunan tomorrow at 11 a.m.
අවාසනාවන්ත විදිහට හෙට දවසේ සාකච්ඡාව බිඳ වැටුණොත් සාකච්ඡාවෙන් අනතුරුව අපි බලාපොරොත්තු වෙනවා නායකත්ව මණ්ඩල රැස්වීම දහවල් දෙකට පවත්වන්න. ඒ දහවල් දෙකේ රැස්වීමෙන් පස්සේ අපි බලාපොරොත්තු වෙනවා අපේ වෘත්ති ක්‍රියාමාර්ගයේ ඉදිරි පදනම මොකක්ද කියලා රටට සහ මහජනතාවට දැනුම් දෙන්න.
Meanwhile, a protest was organized by the junior staff of Ambulipitiya District General Hospital against the criticisms made by the Deputy Director of the Colombo National Hospital, Dr. Rukshan Belina, regarding the strikes carried out by the health professionals unions recently. In other news pertaining to the country's healthcare system, the Doctors' Union Alliance for Medical and Civil Rights revealed that there is a serious shortage of surgical equipment in the country's hospital system.
වෛද්‍ය සැපයුමේකේ ස්වස්ත දත්ත පද්ධතිය අනුව ශල්‍ය උපකරණ හා ශල්‍ය කර්ම සඳහා අවශ්‍ය කරන ප්‍රමුඛතා ලේඛනයේ තිබිය යුතු උපාංග 5800න් 3800කට ආසන්න ප්‍රමාණයක් සම්පූර්ණයෙන්ම ශූන්‍ය තත්ත්වයේ තමයි පවතින්නේ. හෘද රෝගීන්ගේ ශල්‍ය කර්ම සඳහා අවශ්‍ය කරන ස්ටෙන්ට්, අක්ෂිකාච, හිස සිට දෙපතුල දක්වා විවිධාකාර ශල්‍ය කර්ම සඳහා අවශ්‍ය කරන ශල්‍ය උපකරණ, අස්ථි ශල්‍ය කර්ම සඳහා අවශ්‍ය කරන උපකරණ, හදිසි වෛද්‍ය ප්‍රතිකාර ඒකකවල, දැඩි සත්කාර ඒකකවල ශ්වසන ආබාධ තියෙන රෝගීන්ට ශල්‍ය කර්ම සඳහා භාවිතා කරන උපකරණ, මුත්‍රා බට ආදිය පවා සංකීර්ණ ශල්‍ය කර්ම වල ඉඳලා සරල ශල්‍ය කර්ම දක්වා අවශ්‍ය වන අත්‍යවශ්‍ය උපකරණ උපාංග වැඩි ප්‍රමාණයක් මේ මොහොතේ පවතින්නේ ශූන්‍ය තත්ත්වයේ. මේක ඉතාමත්ම භයානක තත්ත්වයක්. මේ තත්ත්වය දිගටම පැවතියොත් ඉදිරි සති කිහිපය ඇතුළත මේ රටේ සෞඛ්‍ය පද්ධතිය බරපතල අර්බුදයකට ලක්වනවා.
However, speaking further in this regard, the Deputy Director General of Medical Services, Dr. G. Vijayasurya, said that surgeries are being performed at maximum capacity in all hospitals at present and surgical equipment are distributed according to need.
Now, in the meantime, President Ranil Wickremesinghe yesterday embarked on an observational tour in the Gaul and Tangaul tourist hotspots. During the tour, President Ranil Wickremesinghe assessed the various issues and challenges pertaining to the industry and took steps to address such issues.
In a move to revitalize Sri Lanka's tourism industry, President Ranil Wickremesinghe embarked on an observational tour in Tangal and Galle yesterday, underscoring the government's commitment to bolster tourism. During the tour, President Ranil Wickremesinghe visited several tourist hotels and engaged in talks with the owners of those hotels to identify their issues and challenges. Subsequently, the President swiftly addressed those issues presented by the business community, liaising with the relevant authorities over the phone to come up with solutions and to get feedback on industry development plans. Meanwhile, the President's tour to the south also included visits to several tourist hotspots such as Sini Modra, Dikvalla, Nilvalla, Hirikatia, Valigama and Habaraduwa, as well as the Valigama Surf School along the southern coast. Further during the visit, President Wickremesinghe held talks with several tourists to find out about their experiences in the country. Accompanying the President on the visit was Jeffrey Dobbs, a foreigner dedicated to enhancing tourist experiences in the region for both local and international tourists. With such new initiatives in place, a significant surge in tourist arrivals was noted in the recent past. In 2023 alone, 1,489,000 tourists visited Sri Lanka, marking a twofold increase from the previous year. Building on this momentum, the government aims to surpass 2.5 million tourist arrivals this year.
Now in other news, U.S. Undersecretary for Public Diplomacy Elizabeth M. Allen, on an official visit to Sri Lanka accompanied by U.S. Ambassador in Colombo Julie Chang, met with Foreign Secretary Arun Vijayawardena, where discussions focused on ways to strengthen people-to-people ties and diaspora outreach. The diplomat also engaged in discussions with future leaders in politics and civil societies and also met with local journalists. She highlighted the United States' unwavering support in Sri Lanka's journey towards economic stability.
U.S. Undersecretary for Public Diplomacy Elizabeth M. Allen arrived in Sri Lanka yesterday for an official visit. The Undersecretary was welcomed by the U.S. Ambassador to Colombo, Julie Chang, upon her arrival. The U.S. State Department in a statement said her visit underscores the United States' unwavering commitment to reinforcing and expanding partnerships and alliances. The U.S. Undersecretary is anticipated to hold talks on freedom of expression and democratic values with diverse groups of stakeholders and the Embassy's Youth Forum during her official visit to Sri Lanka. Issuing a statement, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs said U.S. Undersecretary Allen met with Sri Lanka's Foreign Secretary Arun Vijayawardena at the ministry's premises yesterday. The statement added that discussion centered on several recent positive developments between Sri Lanka and the U.S. in the 75th anniversary year of diplomatic relations. Foreign Secretary Vijayawardena welcomed assistance from the United States in securing the Extended Fund Facility Program under the IMF. The Foreign Ministry's statement added that Undersecretary Allen assured continuous U.S. assistance to the government towards realizing economic stability and discussed ways to strengthen people-to-people ties and diaspora outreach. Taking to the social media platform X, formerly known as Twitter, U.S. Ambassador in Colombo Julie Chang said that she, the U.S. Undersecretary and the Deputy Chief of Mission Douglas Sonic yesterday connected with next-generation leaders working in government, civil societies, climate change activists and businesses. She went on to say that the United States is proud to support young leaders who are the change makers helping to build a stable, prosperous and democratic Sri Lanka. Also in another X message, Ambassador Julie Chang stated that she and the U.S. Undersecretary Secretary Allen met with local journalists as well as alumni of the USG exchange programs and discussed the vital role of media in promoting accountability and transparency to ensure that the public has information to make informed decisions. She added that a robust media and social media space are essential components of any healthy democracy. Replying to Ambassador Chang's X message, U.S. Undersecretary Elizabeth Allen said that all media outlets in democracy serve as checks and balances, allowing for diverse voices to be heard and incorporated. She expressed her gratitude to the journalists in Sri Lanka, who are a testament to the vital role of media in accountability and transparency.
Now bringing to you more news on Sri Lanka's bilateral relationships and foreign ties, Minister of Foreign Affairs of the Islamic Republic of Iran, Dr. Hussein Amin Abdullahian will undertake an official visit to Sri Lanka from the 19th to the 21st of February 2024, accepting an invitation extended by Minister of Foreign Affairs Ali Sabri. During the visit, the Iranian Foreign Minister is scheduled to pay courtesy calls on President Ranil Wickremesinghe and Prime Minister Dinesh Gunawardena. The visiting minister and the delegation will have official discussions with Minister of Foreign Affairs Ali Sabri at the Ministry of Foreign Affairs. In August 2023, the Foreign Minister Ali Sabri and bilateral discussions with the Foreign Minister Dr. Hussein Abdullahian during his official visit to Tehran. Dr. Abdullahian will be accompanied by senior officials from the Office of the President, Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Ministry of Energy and other relevant ministries of Iran. Now, incumbent Treasury Secretary Mahinda Sirivardhana says that the tax base of the country has grown by 130% by the end of 2023 compared to 2022 following the policy decisions which were taken by the government to expand the tax net of the country. Commenting on the powers vested in the government institutions, especially the revenue collecting authorities, Sirivardhana says that the local political culture is such that more focus is placed on individuals rather than institutions, which at times comes at the cost of sustainable policies. While making those comments, the Treasury Secretary also raised concern on whether the parliamentary committees established to create checks and balances did their job, especially in light of the short-sighted 2019 tax cuts.
The policy path in place provides the required increase in revenue, but also in parallel, the tax base is being widened, which will enable tax rates to be eased once revenue targets can be met in a sustainable manner. The early results of this are encouraging, with the tax base increasing by 130% in 2023 compared to 2022. But we have to be patient for the policy measures to yield the required results. If we jump the gun and reverse course too soon, we will be back in a situation like 2002 in no time. In Sri Lanka's government structure, it is unfortunate that not enough attention has been paid to institutional development. In the country's political culture also, there is a tendency to place immense faith in individuals resolving the country's problems. If Sri Lanka's public institutions were stronger, it may have been possible to prevent the ill-thought-out policy measures that contributed to the economic policy. Well, the remit system has been subject to public discussion in the recent past, but the IRD has been struggling with this system since 2013. It was only in 2022 that the required funds were paid to update the system. Therefore, it is disheartening when those who should have been vigilant of the state of public finances, including the performance of revenue institutions, and were silent all this time, now raise their voice to criticize those who are trying their utmost to remedy the situation. Several parliament oversight committees have been in existence throughout the period of fiscal decline leading up to 2022, but whether the expected checks and balances in the public interest have simply materialized before the unprecedented deep and complex economic crisis is questionable. In end 2019, taxes were reduced in order to stimulate economic growth and provide relief to consumers. This creates good results in the short term and is widely popular. This could be compared to a shop that provides a large discount in order to boost sales and achieve their top line growth target quickly. However, this can easily lose sight of the long term impact. The shop may not be able to cover its costs at that discounted price and will run into large losses. The more sustainable option would have been to focus on building government revenues by reversing the 2019 tax cuts, thereby reducing the budget deficit and government financing requirements, keeping inflation expectation in check and enabling interest rate to reduce in a real manner as opposed to artificial means. For a sustained recovery from the economic crisis, Sri Lanka must pursue a qualitatively different type of economic growth, which is led by non-debt creating inflows as opposed to the non-tradable sector. Non-debt creating inflows refers to exports of goods, export of services and FDI. To achieve this, the government has a role in creating macroeconomic stability and an operating environment in which trade and investment can thrive. Towards this end, the government is pursuing FTAs with strategic partners to build market access for Sri Lankan exporters and to make the country attractive for FDIs. Market taxes alone is not sufficient. Supply capacity also needs to be addressed.
Now, in other news surrounding Sri Lanka's financial sector, the Financial Intelligence Unit of Sri Lanka entered into a memorandum of understanding with the Excise Department of Sri Lanka recently, pursuant to the provisions of the Financial Transactions Reporting Act No. 6 of 2006. The MOU was inked with the aim to exchange information related to investigations and prosecutions of money laundering, terrorist financing and other related crimes. The MOU was signed by Commissioner General of the Excise Department, J.M.S.N. Jayasingha, and former Director of the Financial Intelligence Unit, E.H. Mohti, in the presence of Central Bank Governor, Dr. Nandalal Veerasinghe. Dr. Veerasinghe is also the Chairman of the Anti-Money Laundering and Countering of Financing of Terrorism National Coordinating Committee. The MOU between the Excise Department of Sri Lanka and the FIU would enable both institutions to exchange information which is vital for prevention, detection and prosecution of financial offences. Now, independent MP Dr. Nalaka Godaheva in a media briefing today claims that the Central Bank Act, which was passed by a majority in Parliament last year, has vested authority in the Central Bank to give unnecessarily high increments to its employees despite the economic crisis in the country. He said some central bank employees currently serving as deputy governors have been given increments close to around ₹1 million, while the lowest ranking employees of the country's top monetary authority earn close to ₹200,000 a month. Although State Minister of Finance Ranjit Simbalapitiy in fact agreed with Dr. Godeheva's observation on the central bank's authority to decide employee salaries, pursuant to the provisions of the Act, the finance minister held that high remuneration for central bank employees is crucial to retain their services.
මහ බැංකුවේ සේවකයන්ට 70%කට වඩා වැඩි විශාල විදියට වැටුප් වර්ධනය ලබා දෙනවා. නියෝජ්‍ය අධිපතිවරයෙකුට 107කින් විතර පඩි වැඩිලා තියෙනවා. ඊළඟ ඉන්න කෙනෙකුට 105ක විතර පඩි වැඩි වෙලා තියෙනවා. අපිට ආරංචි විදියට කාර්ය සහායකවරයෙකුට පියන් කෙනෙකුට දැන් මේ වන විට වැටුප 183,000 ඉක්මවල යනවා. ඉතින් මේ විදියට අසාධාරණ විදියට වැටුප් වැඩි කර ගන්නට මහ බැංකුවට කොහොමද පුළුවන් වෙලා තියෙන්නේ? එහම පුළුවන් වෙලා තියෙන්නේ පහුගිය දවස්වල ආණ්ඩු විසින්ම මහ බැංකුව ස්වාධීන කරන්න පනතක් ගෙනල්ලා ඔවුන්ට ඒ සියලු බලතල ලබා දීලා තියෙන නිසා.
ඒකෙත් ප්‍රති දෙකක් තියෙනවා. ලෝකෙ හැම මහ බැංකුවක්ම ගන්නේ අති විශේෂ මේ විශේෂ වූ ශ්‍රමයක්. විශේෂ වූ පුද්ගලයෙක් නිසා මහ බැංකුව පනතෙන්ම තියෙනවා. මහ බැංකුවේ තියෙන වැටුප් තලය මේ තීරණය කරන්නේ මහ බැංකුව කියලා ස්වාධීන ආයතනයක් හැටියට. ඒකට හේතුව තමයි මහ බැංකුව වගේ දෙයකට අති විශේෂ මිනිස්සු ගත්තේ නැත්තම් වෙන දෙයක් අපි දැක්කනේ. මේ නැත්තම් ඒ වගේ විශේෂ ශ්‍රමයක් අපිට
Now, Indian envoy in Sri Lanka, Santosh Jha, has expressed confidence regarding the recommencement of the Nagapattinam Kankasanthurai ferry service in the coming weeks, adding that efforts are also underway to resume the ferry service between Thalaimanna and Rameswaram. The Indian High Commissioner has made these remarks during the visit to Kankasanthurai Port and Thalaimanna Pier, where he spoke of the need to expeditiously resume ferry services between the two countries. The Indian High Commission, in a statement, said that the Indian mission in Sri Lanka undertook his official visit to the northern province from the 15th to the 17th of February. The High Commissioner, during the visit, has paid special emphasis to furthering connectivity initiatives, the central theme of the Bilateral Economic Partnership Vision document issued in July 2023, and explored means to strengthen air connectivity through infrastructure development at the Palali Airport. Now, in your political news, opposition legislator Dr. Harshadi Silva says that all party leaders must understand the depth of the economic crisis and present a realistic path to the general public. Meanwhile, government ministers commenting on the upcoming presidential elections said that this is no time for experiments and that the country must elect a leader who has led the country towards progress. Now, let's take a look at some of the latest developments in the political front.
මේ බලවේගයක් වුණාට පස්සේ වසර 70ක සාපේ නිමා වෙනවා අපි අපේ යුගයේ තව මාස 8කින් විතර නිර්මාණ වෙනවා කියන විශ්වාසය අපට තියෙනවා
පක්ෂවල නායකයෝ තේරුම් ගන්න ඕනේ ඇත්තටම අර්බුදේ දිග පළල ගැඹුර කරන්න පුළුවන් මොනවද කරන්න බැරි මොකද්ද කියන එක තේරුම් අරගෙන ඒක යථාර්ථවාදීව ජනතාව ඉදිරියේ තියන්න ඕන
මේ රටේ මිනිස්සු අවුරුදු 72ක් කියලා සාපයක් ගැන කතා කරන්නේ මේ දේශපාලඥයෝ රාජ්‍ය නිලධාරීන්ගෙන් වෙච්ච දේවල් වලට නෙමෙයි මේ සිස්ටම් එකේ වැරද්ද ඒ නිසා තමයි සිස්ටම් එක චේන්ජ් කරන්න කියලා ඉල්ලුවේ ඒක කරන්න පුළුවන් නායකයා කරලා මේ වෙනකොට පෙන්නපු නායකයා රනිල් වික්‍රමසිංහ මහත්තයා ඉදන් තමයි අපි කියන්නේ එතුමා ඉල්ලනවක් නැද්ද කියලා මම දන්නේ ඉල්ලන
Now, in other local developments, the police special task force apprehended two suspects involved in the recent shooting incident at the Meghada Economic Center last afternoon. Accordingly, the two suspects in question, along with another three individuals who assisted in the shooting, were produced before the Home Agama Magistrates Court this afternoon. Meanwhile, in Moragalla, A 47-year-old was recovered dead under mysterious conditions. With that, let's take a look at more news across the island in brief.
Police arrested the gunman and the motorcyclist involved in the recent shooting incident at the Meghada Economic Center, which occurred on the 12th of February. Earlier today, the police reported that two suspects were arrested in Kadavatha in connection with the shooting, while the motorcycle used by the assailants, along with a helmet, a knife, and a shirt, were also recovered from a restaurant. The owner of the restaurant in question, who had kept the motorcycle hidden, and another individual who had provided the suspects with accommodation have been arrested by police for allegedly aiding and abetting the shooting incident. According to the police, the suspects were produced before the Home Agama Magistrates Court this afternoon. Meanwhile, in Moragalla, the corpse of a 47-year-old was recovered. As per police reports, several injuries were observed in the face of the deceased. However, the cause behind the mysterious death remains uncertain and further investigations into the matter are currently underway. In similar news, a 33-year-old was hacked to death last night during a family event. Accordingly, the victim was attacked owing to a personal dispute spiraling into violence. According to police reports, the victim was rushed to Putlam Base Hospital last night. However, he was pronounced dead this afternoon.
Welcome back. Now taking you straight to your business news. In this week's tea auction, a total of 4.8 million kilograms were offered, and leafier low-grown varieties met with good demand, perhaps once again in the backdrop of restricted volumes, whilst the high and medium-grown varieties encountered mixed interest, only Better Westerns reflecting a positive trend. Ex-estate offerings showed a marginal increase on last and totaled 0.74 million kilos. Overall quality of the offerings from the Western Slopes was selectively improved, while the Noor Elias and Uver Udupusel Lavas showed no change. Best Western Select BOP-BOPF invoices appreciated by 50 to 100 rupees per kilogram following quality and special inquiry, whilst the others were irregular. In the high and medium grown category, except for a few select invoices that were barely steady, others declined 100 to 150 rupees per kilogram and more. Corresponding low-grown types, BP1s sold around last week's level, while PF1s, better sorts, were firm and up 50 rupees per kilo easier, whilst the others declined by up to 100 rupees and more. Now in your latest corporate news, Sampad Bank recently announced that its profit before taxes stood at 38.4 billion rupees, an 89.9% increase over the past year's achievement of 20.2 billion rupees, despite the various economic uncertainties. Meanwhile, Horana Plantations PLC announced that non-executive director of the company, S.C. Ganagoda, purchased 10,000 shares at 40 rupees per share and 2,490 shares at 39 rupees and 70 cents per share. With that, let's take a look at more corporate news in brief.
Despite uncertainties and challenging economic conditions throughout the year, Sampad Bank's profit before taxes stood at 38.4 billion rupees, corresponding to an 89.9% compared to previous year's figure of 20.2 billion rupees. However, the profit after tax demonstrated a reduced improvement of 30.5%, rising from 13.1 billion rupees in the previous year to 17.1 billion rupees for the year ended on the 31st of December 2023. In the meantime, Horana Plantations PLC announced the disclosure made by the non-executive director of the company, S.C. Ganagoda, on the purchase of company shares. The company stated that the non-executive director, S.C. Ganagoda, purchased 10,000 shares of 40 rupees per share and 2,490 shares of 39 rupees and 70 cents per share. The statement further added that the dealing took place on the 15th of February and the board of directors were notified on the 16th of February. In other corporate news, Janashakti Insurance PLC announced the appointment of an independent non-executive director to the company. Accordingly, Dilip D.S. Vijayaratna was appointed as an independent non-executive director of the company with effect from the 14th of February. Further, in its corporate disclosure, the company added that the newly appointed director has no relevant interest in the shares of the company as of the 14th of February.
And with that, we wrap up tonight's edition of Adhidharana First at 9. Stay in touch with us on www.adhidharana.lk for the latest developments around the clock. Thank you. Have a great night.
For news and information you can trust 24 hours a day, visit adhidharana.lk.